In this video, we will explore the drawing tools in the new RhinoLands interface, and we will start developing a small public space that we will continue in the following videos. Before we start drawing, it is essential to ensure that we are working in the correct measurement units. At the bottom of the screen, in the status bar, we can see the current units, which in this case is set to meters. If we prefer to work with a different measurement unit, there are two ways to do it. We can either open a new document and select a template that fits our needs, or we can change the units of the current document. To do this, we go to the Properties menu. At the top, we look for the Units tab, and there we can select the one that suits us best. Now that we have our units set up, let's start with the drawing tools. These tools are found in the Drawing tab and are organized from simplest to most complex. First, we have points, which are mainly used as reference points. Among them, we find the simple point, with which we place a point by clicking with the left mouse button, and the command automatically finishes. With multiple points, we can create several points successively until we decide to finish the command. We can do this by pressing the Enter key or by right-clicking. And finally, the point cloud, which allows us to create groupings of points. If we select the previously created points by dragging the cursor and right-clicking to finish, this point cloud will now behave as a single object within the point cloud command. If we look at the command bar, it also offers us other options, in this case to add or remove points from a cloud that we are creating, or in this case, from one that I have previously selected. We select a point, finish, and now we see that the selected point is independent from the rest again. If we want to make all the points independent, we can select them, and in this case, use the explode command in the sidebar. Well, to execute a command, we can do it from its icon as we have done, but we can also enter it by name. Every time we execute one, in the command bar, it will show us the name of it at the bottom according to the language we are working in. If I now press escape, I exit, and could restart it by typing it in. Once started, the same command bar will always guide us through the steps to follow in each of them. At the moment, it asks us for a location. In this case, for a point, we can also enter specific coordinates. For example, let's say we want to create a point here at 3 units on the x-axis, 2 on the y-axis. We can write in the command bar 3.2, and the point is created at this location. Coordinates are always inserted in the order of x, y, and z. If we do not specify the z, it will be projected onto the C-plane or construction plane, which by default is at a Z value of 0. If we indicate 3 coordinates, we are working with a third dimension. We can also specify relative coordinates. For example, if I have created an initial point and want to place the next 1-2 units to the left, 2 units up, we write an R for relative and then 2.2, and this will calculate the position relative to the last point indicated. The rest of the commands we will see work in the same way. In the status bar, we also find options to activate aids in drawing. For example, we can enable or disable snapping to the grid. With this activated, the cursor snaps to the grid, which serves as a measurement reference, considering that each square of the grid corresponds to 1 unit in the measurement we are working with. That is, in this document, this point is located 1 mm from the origin. To activate or deactivate the axis or the grid, we find some options. In the display panel, which if you don't have it on the right, you can open from the panel drop-down at the top. We continue with the group of lines and polylines. To draw a polyline, we start similarly to how we did with the points. In the command bar, it will ask us to indicate a point in the drawing that will be the start of our polyline. From here, we can create a line if we finish the command, or a polyline if we continue adding successive points. If we now look at the command bar, we see that it offers us options. We have options like close or undo. We can access these options by clicking on them or by typing the letter that this option has underlined. For example, with the letter U, I can undo the previously created point, and I can close this curve, either manually joining the end with the starting point or pressing the letter C as a shortcut. When we have finished a command, we can right-click to execute the previous one again. To specify lengths when it asks us for the next point, we can also specify a length for the line. For example, if we type 5, or we can also use decimals by using the point, as well as 5,5, and press Enter, the line is fixed to that length, but we can still direct the next point according to where we move the cursor. To ensure that this line is parallel to the coordinate axis, we will hold down the Shift key. This restricts movement to intervals of 90 degrees, temporarily activating orthogonal mode. If we want to modify the length before setting the second point, we can simply overwrite the value. And by using the less than symbol, we can specify a specific angle. For example, I am going to give it an angle of 30 degrees. I will select and delete the created elements. And to select, you should know that we have several options. We can do this by manually dragging the cursor with the right mouse button pressed. And you should know that if we select from left to right, only those objects that are completely within our section will be chosen. However, if we do it from right to left, any object that intersects our selection area will be selected. We can also use the Select tab to select elements by object type. If we are not very clear on this information, it is indicated in the Properties panel. We also have access from this same tab or from the top bar to select all or to invert selection. To add objects to an already made selection, we can either hold the Shift key to add new selections, or if we want to remove an element, we can do so by holding down the Control key. To draw rectangles, we have several options. We have the corner-to-corner rectangle, where from an initial point, it indicates to enter the length value on the x-axis, followed by the length on the y-axis, rectangle from the center, or rectangle defined from three points. For other polygons, we have the polygon tool. We can specify the number of sides we want it to have. Then there are other additional options like circumscribe polygon, polygon from a vertex instead of from the center, or star shapes. What this allows us is to specify a radius to which to move alternate vertices to create this type of star shapes. We can also specify the number of sides we want for the latter. To draw curves, we use the curve command. This curve is defined by its control points, but if we select it, we will see that it does not pass through them, but rather generates continuity in the curve, in order to connect these segments. We can select these control points independently and move them in order to finish adjusting the 2000-ein curve. The distance of the curve and its control points is something that will be determined by its degree of curvature. Unlike this, we have the interpolated curve, which draws a curve through the positions we select in space. But for this, it will create the necessary control points. In the sidebar, we have commands to edit either the control points or to edit these nodes. Both commands work with both types of curves. Next, there are tools to create circles, ellipses, and arcs with different inputs, always following the steps indicated in the command bar. If we start a circle from the center, it asks us to indicate a starting point in the drawing and a diameter value. With the options, we can change this diameter value to a radius value, entering it either by keyboard or by using a point in the drawing. Now I will skip the ellipses since they work with the same dynamics, and we will draw arcs. To do this, I will position myself from the front and shape what will be a wall from the front view with some lines that we will connect using arches. The first arch starts from the center, so if we want to start from the middle of these two lines, by activating the snaps, we can indicate which object references we want the cursor to detect. For example, in this case, we are interested in the midpoint, and by activating Smart Track, temporary references are activated that serve as guides, remembering the points where the cursor has passed. For example, if I want to start an arch from the midpoint between these two lines, I can pass through one point, then pass through the other, and I look for the center on this line. Since we have indicated the midpoints, it shows me the halfway point here. Subsequently, we indicate the starting point of the arch and the end point. We have other arches with different orders in the inputs, such as initial point, end point, and direction of the arch, among others. Well, the next group gathers the curve editing tools and drawing tools, and we will start creating the D of the representation of this public space to show them. when editing geometry. In the sidebar, we have some generic commands that you can explore, which work for all elements. For example, for those options to copy, move, rotate, and scale, you will find the first four buttons. If, for example, I create a square corresponding to a green area, I could use the Move tool and, with the object reference, move from the center of the first rectangle to the center of this other rectangle. For these actions, we also have the gumball. Each color we see on it corresponds to one of the coordinate axes. The arrows move the object in one direction. If we click on it, we can specify a positive or negative distance for this movement. If we want to make a copy, we can click on the arrow while holding the Alt key. And a copy will be created with the displacement, but it will not remove the object from its current position. If we drag from the arches, they rotate the object, and it can be rotated either freely or by a specific value. And from the square at the ends, we can scale in one dimension, or if we hold down the Shift key, this object will scale in all its dimensions. The orientation of the gumball can be set in the status bar with the right button. For example, if it is currently oriented according to the object, it can also be changed to respect the universal coordinate orientation. Other tools we find are the Join tool, which, for example, right now these arches and lines are independent, but we could select them and join them into one. On the contrary, the Explode command allows us to decompose elements, for example, to decompose a rectangle to obtain its four edges, and move just one. Next, we have the Cutting and Splitting tools. The cuts work according to the view we are in. Although two curves or objects do not intersect in space, if they do in one of the views, for example, if I move this edge to the front, from the front view, it allows using this as a cutting object and trimming the excess from the sidelines. First, we select the object we want to use as the cutting tool, press Enter, and then select the elements to cut. The Cut tool removes these parts that we selected, while the Split tool would divide the curves but not remove them from the drawing. And with the Group command, we can group those objects that are of different types or that are not in contact with each other, so that when selecting one, the rest are also selected. Then we can use Ungroup if we want to undo this grouping. Okay, let's go back to the Drawing tab and see those specific curve editing tools. Some of the tools we find are the Offset tool, which creates a curve equidistant from another. For example, we can create an equidistant edge to this rectangle and then incorporate a different pavement. And what it asks us is to indicate at what distance we want to make this offset. I will give it a value of 2 menu, and with the cursor, we just define which side of the curve we want to create it. With Fillet, we can join two curves with an arc by indicating its radius. For example, we can use it to round corners or to join curves that are not in contact. With Chamfer, we would do the same, but by creating a straight segment between the two lines we select. To see the following commands, I will create a curved line that will be a small pond of water that will go through these green areas. Once I have a curve, let's suppose that when drawing it, I finished it here, and now what I want is to extend it. With the Extend command, we can extend the last control point, but it will maintain the curvature of this line. As you can see, it moves the last point but does not create an additional point. Another possibility is that at a given moment, I have two curves that I have drawn separately, and I want to join them while controlling the continuity between them. For this, we use the Equalize command. First, we select the curve we want to modify, and then the curve we want to equalize to. This dialog appears where we can select what continuity we want them to have, whether to match them in position, tangency, or curvature. And right now, only the first curve we selected is being modified. But there is also an option to modify both at their average. And before accepting the result, we can also choose to merge them to form a single curve. The Rebuild tool redefines the points of a curve. In parentheses, it indicates the number of control points it currently uses, and we can specify a new value next to it. Here, it is always advisable to work with the smallest possible values, as this results in smoother curves. And the same goes for the degree of curvature. These changes are previewed at all times. So when we have the curve we are satisfied with, we accept it, and this curve will be redrawn with the new parameters. Curve symmetry has a uniqueness compared to the reflect command that we find in the sidebar. While reflect allows us to select elements and define a line from which to create symmetry, curve symmetry allows us to make a tangent copy to the original curve. The Boolean operation joins parts based on overlapping regions. If I select all the drawing curves, I can extract the outline of those regions that I am selecting. Supersampling, like Boolean, selects a region, but from this region, it creates a surface and assigns a texture based on the image we select. The image command allows us to select an image from our computer to insert into the drawing. We will use this later. Finally, something I also wanted to show is when making multiple copies of an element, we have the array tool. There are different types. It can be used to make copies of an object along a curve. It can be done in a circular shape with the polar array or rectangular, with a circle. I will represent what will be the tree pits where we will place trees, and I can define how many copies I want in each direction. For example, 5 on the x-axis, 2 on the y-axis, and 1 on the z-axis. Now it asks us to enter distances and shows us a preview. At this moment, we can also correct some of the parameters before finishing. Today we have covered what the drawing tools in RhinoLands are, and we have started to shape our project. I will leave it like this, trimming some intersections. You can create your own designs and spaces, and in the next tutorial, we will continue showing some modeling tools, and in the future, we will add other elements like terrain or civil engineering elements.